understanding of oxygen therapy, especially in the wake of increasing number of COVID cases presenting with respiratory symptoms and signs and requiring oxygen therapy, I think this session will be useful to all. Now, the objectives of this session is to understand the people in the hospital, also to understand the different oxygen delivery interfaces available and its indications and contraindications. Once we provide oxygen therapy to these patients, we should be able to assess the adequacy of oxygen therapy. Also, we'll have to consider some special populations like COPD patients where oxygen therapy can be harmful at times. Now, coming to the basics of oxygen administration, we should know what is oxygen therapy. Oxygen therapy is supplementation of oxygen in addition to the air, ambient air oxygen to a patient with an intention of either preventing or treating any respiratory problems. Now the question is, like, what is the oxygen in ambient air? As we know, ambient air, so we are trying to replace this nitrogen part with supplementing additional oxygen. Now the question is, when to give? We can give oxygen when patient is having a respiratory problem, exhibiting an SpO2 of less than 90% and a saturation of oxygen less than 60%. We'll come to it in detail later. Now the question also comes, like, who should start the oxygen? Ideally, any clinical staff can start oxygen, but at the prescription of a medical officer. But at times, at bedside, what happens is suddenly one patient collapses with a respiratory symptom, maybe with an acute MI, arrhythmia, or a cardiac arrest, or a sudden onset of breathlessness. In these situations, the attending clinical staff can start oxygen, but make sure the staff should start oxygen at high flows, not at low flows. And a medical officer should review the case as early as possible and titrate oxygen therapy according to the oxygen requirement. Now, there are multiple factors we have to see whether the patient is getting oxygenated adequately. There are so many factors, like even if we supplement oxygen, there are other factors in the background that should also satisfy to carry this oxygen to the tissues. Any supplementation of oxygen is intended to increase the oxygen delivery at the tissue level. The main function of respiration, external and internal respiration, is to carry oxygen from the ambient air, to pass it through the lungs, oxygenate the blood. The hemoglobin should be fully saturated, carry it through the circulation in the arterial blood, take to the tissues, deliver the oxygen at the tissue level, and take it back through the venous side and back to the lung. Now, the basic requirements, at least there should be a hemoglobin concentration of more than 7 g/dL. The pH should be at least more than 60 millimeters of mercury, and the circulation should be adequate so that the blood with the hemoglobin saturated with oxygen is carried to tissues adequately. Now, primarily, the oxygen therapy aims at increasing PaO2. Now, there are a few terminologies we come across while looking at oxygen therapy. One is a partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood. This usually we see with an ABG. And second is a saturation, SaO2, which is a percentage of hemoglobin saturated with oxygen. This value also we find from an ABG. SpO2, this is an non-invasive method of assessing saturation of oxygen in blood. And this is usually done by pulse oximetry. And this is the commonest mode available for us for bedside monitoring. And fourth one is a fraction of inspired oxygen. Fraction of inspired oxygen, as we said, in room air is 20%. The moment we start supplementing oxygen, we are trying to increase the FiO2 supplemented to the patient. So this is important. Like what at what FiO2 are you achieving? What oxygenation level is very important. Now there are few precautions we should keep in mind when we are providing oxygen. One is a prolonged oxygen therapy, which can result in ciliary dysfunction. If we provide high flow or high concentration of oxygen for a long time, it can be harmful also because oxygen is a free radical, which is very harmful. It can cause oxygen toxicity, absorption atelectasis, oxidative damage to pneumocytes, which can cause permanent damage to the lung. And special caution in providing oxygen should be exercised while treating COPD patients. And always ensure, once you start oxygen therapy, ensure uninterrupted supply of oxygen throughout the therapy till any change is made. Now, what is important, as I said earlier, we are carrying from the inhaled part, we are carrying oxygen from the inhaled oxygen to the lungs, to the heart, left heart, aorta, and then to the tissues. And your aim is to provide oxygen at the tissue level so that mitochondria can use up this oxygen and perform the cellular functions. Enough energy is released only in the presence of oxygen. Aerobic respiration happens at the mitochondrial level only if sufficient oxygen is provided. Now, let us see. Imagine we are considering 100 ml of blood in the aorta. This is supposed to be the most saturated blood in the body. Now, 100 ml of blood in the aorta, if we consider, we'll calculate the oxygen content. This is what is called CaCO2. In this blood, actually, oxygen is carried in two different forms. One is bound to hemoglobin, and second is in the dissolved form. Bound to hemoglobin is the majority, it's a major part, and the dissolved fraction is only a very, very minute fraction. We'll come across it later. The formula for finding out the oxygen bound to hemoglobin is given as hemoglobin into 1.34 into saturation of oxygen. This means like 1 gram of fully saturated blood, which is 100% saturated. That means all the four sites are saturated for each hemoglobin, and majority of the hemoglobin is saturated well. And we are considering one hemoglobin molecule or 1 gram of hemoglobin molecule when 100% saturated will carry 1.34 ml of oxygen. This is the calculation which comes as hemoglobin multiplied by 1.34 into saturation of oxygen. And the dissolved fraction will be something like 0.003 into partial pressure of oxygen, which forms only a minute fraction. Now, if you go into the calculation, the hemoglobin bound to hemoglobin, the oxygen bound to hemoglobin will come to only 20.1 ml, while the dissolved oxygen in 100 ml of blood will come to only 0.3 ml. This together makes something like 20.4 ml of oxygen carried in 100 ml of blood in on the arterial side. We come to further calculations like approximately 1 liter on the arterial side carries 200 ml of oxygen, and equivalent to cardiac output, if we consider 5 liter, which goes in 1 minute to the tissue level, will carry 1000 ml of oxygen. Now, is this enough or is it in excess? This is the question. Now, what is actually needed at the tissue level? Oxygen delivered at the tissue level in 1 minute is around 1 liter, and the oxygen actually needed at the tissue level is only 200 ml, considering all the tissues in the body, over a minute. Now, reserve oxygen delivered at the tissue level is approximately 4 times more. Like altogether, the supply is almost 5 times the requirement, and 800 ml per minute is supplied in excess. When do the patients start exhibiting respiratory symptoms or breathing problems? This is actually when the reserve is also being used up. Now, coming to this is very useful. The next thing is this slide is very useful in clinical practice. Actually, practically, this is a simple classification of hypoxemia. If we see the average PO2 of a normal population, we will see that partial pressure of oxygen is somewhere between 80 to 100. When it falls from 60 to 70, and we call it mild hypoxia. And if it falls further below 60, this is the crucial point we have to target. Mild hypoxemia to moderate hypoxemia, the switch from 60 millimeters of partial pressure to 59 millimeters of partial pressure of oxygen. This is the point we have to add. Keep a note of this point. And severe hypoxemia, partial pressure of oxygen will be something like less than 40 millimeters of mercury. See the corresponding saturation of oxygen we see in the arterial blood. Like for a normal person with a partial pressure of oxygen 80 to 100, the saturation will be approximately more than 95%. And mild hypoxemia, which we come across so many patients, we don't treat them usually. With a partial pressure of oxygen 60 to 79, also the saturation shows somewhere above 90. It will be something like 90 to 94. Now comes the crucial point. Switch from mild hypoxemia to moderate hypoxemia. Partial pressure of oxygen in the ABG shows 40 to 59, and the saturation of oxygen in the blood gas analysis shows something like 75 to 89. Coming to the severe hypoxemia, the patient will be extremely symptomatic at this stage because the arterial blood is showing a picture something similar to the venous blood. Like the ABG will show a pattern something similar to a VBG. Here the partial pressure of oxygen is less than 40 and saturation is less than 75. It's important to identify the point where we have to act rather than pushing the patient to a severe hypoxemic state. Now, this is based on our old teaching about the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. Now, the same thing what I mentioned now is depicted on this graph with partial pressure of oxygen on the x-axis and the hemoglobin saturation with oxygen on the y-axis. As I said earlier, go through the PaO2 80 to 100 on the x-axis. You can see a horizontal part, which is a plateau part. And it will correspond something like 95 to 100% saturation on the graph. Coming to the mild hypoxemia 60 to 79, you can still see the graph is still showing a plateau phase. It started to descend, but it is still in the plateau phase, and the saturation at this time is also showing something nearby, around 90 plus minus. But the moment it reaches the point of partial pressure 60, you can see a steep fall in the hemoglobin saturation of oxygen. From this point, at this point, if you don't supplement oxygen, the patient is going to rapidly desaturate. That is the reason we should start supplementing oxygen at this point. Now, considering a special population like chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or COPD, the primary problem in them, they usually have high PaCO2 and low PaO2. The high PaCO2, actually in a normal population, the respiratory trigger from one breath to next breath is by an elevated PaCO2 sensed by the central chemoreceptors located in the brainstem. For these people, the PaCO2 is chronically elevated and the central chemoreceptors become insensitive. For them, actually, the respiratory drive from one breath to next breath is by peripheral chemoreceptors, which will sense a low PaO2 level. For them, actually, low PaO2 is the respiratory trigger. It is at this juncture, we find this patient going into respiratory failure and we initiate oxygen. What actually happens, like the PaO2 goes up, and instead of doing some benefit, it might harm the patient if it is not properly titrated. For these patients, the PaO2 should be titrated to only 60 to 70%, and saturation SpO2 should be targeted only 88 to 90%. Now, the idea is to minimize, like if you are supplementing oxygen and the PaO2 goes up, the peripheral chemoreceptor doesn't trigger the next breath, the patient might go into oxygen-induced hypoventilation. There can be hypercarbia and carbon dioxide induced narcosis. So we have to be careful about this. Now the next thing, like we should be familiar with the oxygen supply sources in the hospital. Usually in the hospital, oxygen is supplied by pipeline systems, which comes from a central supply. And central supply is usually from a manifold. this is a group of cylinders arranged in two sets. One is a primary supply and another is a secondary supply. The primary supply and the secondary supply should have at least two cylinders each, or up to a maximum of 20 cylinders on each side. Usually the primary supply will be used at first and then the secondary supply. Ideally, each hospital setup should be having oxygen supply lasting for at least 2 days, but should be, if possible, should be available for at least 1 week as reserve. It all depends on how many patients the hospital is catering to and how much oxygen requirement is there for that particular hospital. Now, the oxygen is stored in manifold in the liquefied cryogenic form at -150 degrees centigrade, and it is converted into the ordinary gaseous form, and the pressure at which it is stored is changed to something less than 50 psi before supplementing to the patient pressure reducing valve. So by the time the oxygen reaches the patient, the pressure is reduced. Now, the second source of oxygen in the hospital or we come across is the cylinder supply. Cylinder supply might cause interruption in supply if we don't adequately store enough cylinders. This is more important when we are transporting a patient from one point in the hospital to another point, or when we transfer patient from one hospital to another facility. This, we have to have a basic knowledge of the cylinders. Now, as I said before, the first diagram shows a picture of a flow meter assembly. The screw cap is connected to the wall outlet in the room. Oxygen supply from the pipeline. The pressure gauge will indicate what is the final oxygen pressure delivered to the patient. And oxygen is taken through a humidifier bottle where it is humidified. And the flow meter above will show a value. The upper limit of the rotating ball, which is called the rotameter, actually indicates how many liters of oxygen are being supplemented to the patient per minute. Make sure that the rotameter is a working one. If it is stuck at one point, it will not be delivering whatever oxygen we are expecting for the patient to get. So make sure in the beginning when we open the flow meter, we have to make sure the rotameter is a moving one, rotating one. Now, the oxygen can be connected to the oxygen output. Now, the second one is the cylinder. Cylinders are of different sizes and are of different weights. Ideally, freestanding cylinders should be, the smaller ones should be put in a cylinder trolley, and the larger cylinders should be kept against a wall and, if possible, chained to a safe area. This is to prevent injuries with the fall of the cylinders on somebody. Now, I want to stress on this oxygen pressure gauges connected to the oxygen cylinders. You can see a red mark showing something from 0 to 6,000. This is the value in PSI. And in the second pressure gauge, there is something written as refill, half, three, fourth. At 2,000, it is written as full. So every time we are using a cylinder for Hello, am I audible?
Yes, madam, paranju madam. madam kekka paranjo
just let me put the Now we are speaking about the cylinder supply and the pressure gauges. Now let's have a look at this slide. Like we have color-coded oxygen cylinders in India, which is usually black colored with a white shoulder, and it comes in different sizes like B, D, E, F, G, H, and M, of varying capacities, varying pressures, and varying valve types. Valve types, actually, the pin index of the bullnose is a safety system of using it. Now, usually look at the E cylinder, which is a common cylinder we come across. And here, the maximum pressure when it is full is something like 1900 psi. And the capacity, the full capacity is only 660 liters. As the pressure drops, the proportional volume of oxygen stored in the cylinder also decreases. So we should know, like, this cylinder, when we are taking with a patient for transportation, how long it will last. The bigger cylinders are also available. M-type cylinders are available, but it's not usually used for a transfer. Now, this is an important slide. Like, you should know how long the oxygen cylinder will last. Have additional cylinders during a patient transfer. Now, there is a calculation given which I found. This is the duration of oxygen flow left is equal to the current cylinder pressure into a conversion factor divided the flow rate we are setting. Imagine we are showing the something like 1500 psi and we are providing 2 liters per minute. Now, this is a standard thing. The conversion factor for E cylinder is a standard thing. This is 0.28. So we have to multiply this divided by the flow rate, which is 2 liters per minute. And we know now our cylinder is going to last for 210 minutes at this flow rate we are set for the patient. Imagine a patient is requiring high levels of oxygen. You have put something like 15 liters or a 10 liter. Definitely the cylinder is going to not going to last for 210 minutes. Now imagine another situation with an E cylinder. Showing pressure gauge showing 1000 psi, and we have a set a flow rate of something like 10 liters per minute. The same formula will show us that 1000 into the conversion factor divided by 10 liter per minute will last for only 28 minutes. With this knowledge, we should be able to arrange extra cylinders after we know like how long we are going to be in the transit. Now, coming to the next session, like we come across a patient with respiratory problem and we have so many devices with us, like to supplement oxygen, which to use when is a question. Now that we have low flow delivery devices and high flow delivery devices. Low flow oxygen delivery device use are nasal cannula, simple face mask, and a partial rebreathing mask. Now, high flow delivery devices, there is a venturi mask, also we use commonly, non-rebreathing mask, high flow nasal cannulas, tracheostomy collars or aerosol mask. But our area of interest is the first three, the venturi mask, non-breathing mask, and the HFNO. Now, coming to the low flow oxygen devices, these are variable performance devices and patient dependent devices. These patients can be devices can be used in patients who are relatively stable but needs oxygen. Imagine the patient's requirement or the minute volume is only less than 8 to 10 liters of per minute. Respiratory rate is something like less than 20. Oxygenation is not adequate, and inspiratory flow requirement, they are not taking any deep breaths or an air hunger, and the inspiratory flow requirement is something like 10 to 30 liter per minute. The tidal volume is something like less than 0.0. These are all approximate values, and we cannot gauge. It is from observation that we gauge like whether this patient requires a low flow device or something more. and high flow oxygen delivery devices. They are fixed performance devices and they provide high FiO2 and they are patient independent. They can be used when severe hypoxia is present, when high FiO2 is needed to tackle their hypoxia, and when inspiratory flow requirement is more than 40 liters per minute, something like patients having real air hunger, like in COPD or bronchial asthma patients. Now, coming to individual entities, the commonest one we come across, and everybody is familiar with this, is a nasal cannula. And through a nasal cannula, we can supplement, like as I said earlier, when no oxygen is supplemented, patient is having an approximate FiO2 of 0.2. And supplementing 1 liter extra will add an FiO2 of 4%. So 20% oxygen patient was having, we are adding 4% oxygen. That makes 24/100, which is equivalent to an FiO2 of not percentage, it is just 0.24. And every liter added will add something like 4% oxygen to the patient. So ideally, it is expected that a nasal cannula, which will provide from 1 liter to 6 liter per minute, can provide an FiO2 of 0.24 to 0.44. But we usually give oxygen through a nasal cannula only up to 4 liters per minute. The reason is, even though it can be provided, like 5 liters or 6 liters can be provided, it can cause drying of nasal mucosa and might be uncomfortable to the patient. If you see the picture, this person is actually enjoying a nasal cannula and he's doing his oral routine activities. He's making a phone call, he can eat, he can drink, whatever activities he wants, he can do. So somebody who is requiring low levels of oxygen, nasal cannula is the best option. Now imagine with this oxygen supplementation is not sufficient and patient needs something like 5 liters or more. We go to the next option, which is a simple face mask or a Hudson mask. Now with a Hudson mask, we can provide oxygen up to 5 to 10 liters, but 5 liters minimum should be there because the dead space will be the one patient will be breathing if you give any supplemental oxygen with a Hudson mask less than 5 liters. And we can provide something like 0.4 to 0.6 with varying flow rates. Now, coming to mask with reservoir bag, this is actually, the oxygen is stored in the bag. Exhaled air is, this is the partial rebreathing mask. Exhaled air is also going to the mask. Fresh air is also going into the reservoir bag. And patient is rebreathing from the mask. With this, we can achieve, with high flows, we can achieve an FiO2 up to 0.8. Now coming to the Venturi fixed performance devices, Venturi mask, it's also known as high airflow oxygen entrainment device. This works on Bernoulli's principle. As you see in the initial part of this slide, oxygen is passed through a narrow tube, which is further narrowed at the exit. As the size of the exit narrows, it creates a higher jet of oxygen. And at this point, it will create a vacuum, a suction force. And there are some entrainment ports around this area where atmospheric air can be suctioned in. The narrower the exit of the oxygen flow, the more oxygen will be entrained into this area. And the oxygen mixes with the entrained air and a fixed FiO2 can be delivered. Like there are two things we can fix, the size of the entrainment port and the size of the exit of oxygen. If we fix this, we can give a fixed amount of oxygen. Imagine if we narrow the exit part of the tube, the more it is narrow, it will create a higher jet and more air will be sucked in and it will cause a reduction in the FiO2. And if by any chance the entrainment port is covered by a blanket and we set it as something like 15 liters and we expect a 0.6 FiO2, this might provide FiO2 higher because less air will be entrained in, FiO2 will be higher. Now, you can see in the second part, like 100% oxygen is delivered, air is entrained entrainment port mixed. There are exhalation ports on the mask where patient can exhale out. And all this works only if the mask is snugly fit and the straps should be pulled so that the mask is perfectly fit. Now coming to different venturi masks available. The venturi valves actually vary. These are connected to the valves. Actually, the venturi valves are changed. Different color-coded venturi valves are available. And each from blue to green, venturi valves will provide different FiO2, but only if we provide the sufficient flow rate as described or as prescribed. Like only if we provide 2 liters per minute in a blue venturi, we will be able to provide 25% and consider the green one to provide, which is expected to, in the best conditions, it is expected to provide an FiO2 of 60.6. But the flow rate has to be 15 liters per minute, otherwise it will not suffice. Now, coming to non-rebreathing valves, masks. These are masks with reservoir bags, but the only thing is the exhaled air is expelled from the mask through the exhalation port. And pure oxygen is filling the reservoir mask, and there is a one-way valve which allows only pure oxygen to reach the patient. So FiO2 of 35 to 60% can be achieved, but up to 100% can be achieved if you are providing 15 liters of oxygen. This can be provided for patients requiring high oxygen. Now there are bag valve devices or AMBU self-limiting bags, which we are very familiar with. These can provide an FiO2 of more than 90%. There should be an adequate mask fill. High flow oxygen, constant supply should be provided. But in unconscious patients, there is a risk of aspiration. But this is not a permanent device which can keep the patient without hypoxia. This is only a temporary measure before we go into a definite interface. I'll come to something very new, which is HFNO. It is also known as TRI or mini CPAP. TRI means transnasal humidified rapid inflammation ventilatory exchange. This device, the HFNO, this is high flow nasal oxygen cannula. As the name suggests, it provides high flow, something like more than 30 liters to up to 100 liters you should be able to provide. Usually 30 to 60 liters is the one used at the flow meter. And there is a blender which will blend oxygen and air to provide the particular FiO2. And there's a large tubing connected to the humidifier. And from the heated and humidified air oxygen mixture passes through a single exhalation, a single inspiratory tube, which will reach the patient, and patient is provided oxygen at high flows through a nasal cannula. Now, advantages of HFNO. Like as I said earlier, the flow meter is there, the blender, air oxygen blender, you can see in the figure. There is an active humidifier and a heated inspiratory circuit which carries it to the patient. You can see a bottle with water, which should be higher than the humidifier bottle. And the humidifier bottle itself should be lower than the patient. And the advantages of HFNO is it will decrease the anatomical dead space. And it provides PEEP. It provides a constant FiO2, which is very high FiO2, and provides good humidification. These are the qualities we actually need when we are providing oxygen therapy. Like large flow of oxygen, like high flow oxygen, like 30 liters to 60 liters to a patient, coming through the nostril to the pharynx, it will create a turbulence at the pharyngeal area, and it will exhale. It will push out all the exhaled carbon dioxide, which will allow more oxygen to diffuse into the alveoli, thereby increasing the alveolar ventilation. And that is the advantage of decreasing the anatomical dead space. Now it provides PEEP. It is also called a mini PEEP device because at approximately 60 liters per minute flow, it can, with the mouth shut, it can create a PEEP of 7. And if the person opens his mouth, the PEEP or the CPAP, it provides something like 3 to 4 centimeters of water. This is an added advantage because these patients requiring high concentrations of oxygen, the airway will still remain open during expiration. This can provide high FiO2, which is titrated, and the heated humidifier device will provide good humidification. And the high flow rates provided something like 50 to 100 liter per minute exceeds patient's inspiratory flow rates, even in a patient with air hunger. Causes when this happens, there is decreased entrainment of room air, and that is how it achieves high FiO2. Now coming to the next slide, Thrive or the HF endo actually helps in ventilatory exchange. It causes rapid insufflation of the lung. It can be given transnasally. It gives good humidification. Now, what are the indications of HF endo? HF endo can be given in case of hypoxemic exacerbation of COPD, in theater or in ICU where we are planning to intubate or we are planning to extubate before intubation, and after extubation we can give HF endo. In cases of sleep apnea, it's also a good option also in congestive heart failure. If somebody has decided not to resuscitate their ward, in this DNR situations also this will be useful. But there are a few contraindications which will limit its use, like if the patient has some partial airway obstruction or a disrupted airway, or if a patient has a known contagious pulmonary infection. This is actually contraindicated, but it's a relative contraindication. Intracranial hypertension, patients on bleomycin therapy, and children below 16 years, it's said to produce some pneumothorax, so it's contraindicated. Patients on bleomycin therapy, they're not supposed to have high concentrations of oxygen. That is the contraindication. And regarding pulmonary infections, and in the current scenario of COVID, increasing cases, we don't know whether HF endo will be of use at some time when we are out of our ventilatory reserve. Like real ventilators are the ideal ones to be used in these patients with severe respiratory symptoms, but we don't know the gravity of the situation and what the future holds. And if the number of ventilators outnumber, if the patients, COVID patients outnumber the available ventilators, one HF endo might be a possibility in a respiratory isolation ward or a COVID isolation ward or a COVID exclusive ICU, not in a public place. Now, a word about humidification. Now, we inspire air, which is warm and dry. It passes through the nose, upper airway, reaches the trachea and reaches the lungs. Now in the upper airway, the inspired air is at a temperature of something like 22 degrees centigrade and a relative humidity of 40%. At the trachea, our body adds temperature to this inspired air, and the temperature reaches something like 32 degrees centigrade, and the relative humidity, this is by condensation of the water vapor which is added, the relative humidity comes to 40%. In the lungs, the temperature, the ideal situation expected in the lungs is a temperature of 37 degrees centigrade and a relative humidity of 99%. This is a normal mechanism happening in a spontaneously breathing patient. Imagine we are providing dry air or unconditioned air without humidification. We are not adding heat. We are not adding water vapor. These things will not happen, and the absolute humidity at the lung level will be very low. So this might create some problems, like the common problems with unconditioned inspired gas are increased in airway resistance and a decreased mucociliary clearance, which will delay the recovery of the patient. So humidification is a very important part of oxygen therapy, and there are different humidifying systems available to us. The common one we are familiar with is bubble humidifiers, which is a bubble bottle, which is connected to the oxygen flow meters. And second is the HMEs we use. HMEs will not add humidity, but it helps in preventing loss of water vapor. And it has an additional filter to prevent bacterial infections. Now, the other systems available are the humidifying system, the Fisher Paykel heated and humidified systems, which will provide sufficient humidification and heating. But the problem is a little bit expensive, and not all centers will be having such equipments. Now, as I said before, humidification bottles, heat moisture exchangers, and advanced humidifier systems are available to match the natural situation of humidification or natural conditioning. But all these systems are not as effective as our natural mechanisms. Now, coming to the next session, we are providing oxygen to the patient. We should know, like, what is the oxygen requirement for this patient, and after supplementing oxygen, we should know how to monitor the adequacy of oxygen therapy. So how do we do it? Now, the best thing at the bedside is to look at the symptoms of the patient. Now, it is actually a symptom analysis of different body systems, like the patient exhibiting dyspnea because the patient is not able to breathe properly, and the rest are other systems like work of the heart and work of the brain. Work, like, whenever oxygen is not sufficiently provided, the heart will compensate by increasing circulation by providing increased cardiac output, and this will manifest externally as palpitation or angina. And if the perfusion is not sufficient, the end organs, for example, which will manifest immediately is the brain, they will manifest with confusion and disorientation. Now, looking at the vital signs, the same systems, we'll see how they work. Vital signs is something medical personnel can see. The other part, actually, any lay person can assess. Like with the respiratory system, lungs, you can see whether the patient is having bradypnea or tachypnea. Or the heart, you can see whether there is an increase in heart rate or increase or decrease in heart rate. The other organs which we are observing is oliguria. If there is no end organ perfusion, kidney will not work properly and the urine output will be decreased. The brain, this will manifest earlier than this oliguria. The brain will manifest as altered sensorium, altered GCS. End organ perfusion will be decreased because the oxygen at the periphery, at the tissue level, if it is low, it can manifest as cyanosis or pallor. Now, once you come across such a situation, I have come across these situations many a times, but there are few simple things we have to cross-check. Like, we have prescribed a particular amount of oxygen or particular volume of oxygen to be delivered per minute. First of all, we have to see whether the oxygen is delivered as prescribed. Now, the second error, what happens is the oxygen interface, the mask, or the nasal cannula is not placed properly, and there is a leak by the side, or the nasal cannula is pulled out. So this is another thing. And the third thing is the flow meter, whether there is a leak at the flow meter site, or is the rotameter moving? Is the patient getting the prescribed amount of oxygen before we make a change? This is what you have to look. Now, bedside assessment, other than the symptoms and the clinical signs, is by our common monitor, which is a pulse oximetry. Bedside, in any rooms, we can use a stat a pulse oximetry or an SpO2, stat SpO2. And in ICUs, where a continuous monitoring is possible, we can use continuous pulse oximetry. Stat monitoring, they say there is an error of around 3%, but with continuous SpO2 monitoring, with the plethysmograph available on the screen and continuous reading coming, we can believe that reading, and this error is supposed to be reduced with a continuous plethysmography and pulse oximetry. Now, the another way, other than symptoms, assessment of signs, pulse oximetry at bedside, whenever possible, it is essential to do an arterial blood gas, which will give the real picture. Pulse oximetry was external or non-invasive manifestation of saturation of oxygen. Now we can see the actual saturation of oxygen and the actual PO2 by doing the arterial blood gas. There are 5 parameters we can assess with an arterial blood gas analysis. One is a PaO2, second is an arterial saturation of oxygen in the arterial blood, Third is a PF ratio. Fourth is a alveolar arterial gradient. And fifth is a arterial oxygen content, CaCO2. PaO2, as I mentioned earlier, in a normal person is more than 80. And we call it hypoxia when PaO2 goes below 80 millimeters of mercury. Saturation in the normal arterial blood, saturation is 95 to 100. But if the patient has a hypoxia or the sample is having a venous admixture, the saturation of oxygen can show something like 75 to 90. Now, a normal venous sample, if you are taking, the saturation might show, VBG can show a saturation less than 75%. Now, the third parameter we are assessing is the PF ratio, which is actually a ratio of the partial pressure of inspired oxygen, partial pressure of oxygen in the blood, and the fraction of inspired oxygen, PaO2 by FiO2. The normal value is more than 400. If the value becomes equal to or less than 300, we consider ARDS if other parameters also suffice. And the fourth parameter we'll be assessing is the alveolar arterial oxygen gradient. What is alveolar arterial oxygen gradient? We in the alveoli, we consider alveoli is having more oxygen because it's coming from the atmosphere or supplemented oxygen. The lungs are filled with oxygen, which is more concentrated. And this is diffusing to the blood circulating through the lung and reaching the arterial side. If the diffusion part, if there is a problem with the alveoli, if there is a problem with the diffusion part, or if there is a problem with the circulation part, there will be a wider gradient. The diffusion will be less. The alveoli will have much more oxygen content than the arterial content. So a normal alveolar arterial gradient of 5 to 25 millimeters of mercury is acceptable. It can be widened in some situations. Now, arterial oxygen content we have discussed before. It is the oxygen bound to hemoglobin plus oxygen dissolved in plasma. Now, more about the alveolar arterial oxygen gradient. Alveolar arterial oxygen gradient, as I said, is the difference in the partial pressure of oxygen in the alveoli and the gradient between this and the partial pressure of oxygen in the arterial side. There's a formula to calculate the partial pressure of oxygen in the alveoli, PaO2. This is actually given as FiO2 into atmospheric pressure minus water vapor pressure minus PaCO2 by 0.8. PaO2 or the arterial O2 is usually measured from the arterial blood. There is, the question I saw, the question was, is there any correlation between SpO2 and PaO2? Hello? Hello? The question was, somebody has flashed a question like whether there is any connection between SpO2 and PaO2. This is what I showed in the previous slide, like PaO2 somewhere more than 95, the saturation will show, saturation in blood will show something more than 90. And when the saturation falls, the corresponding fall in SpO2 will also happen. If PaO2 falls, saturation will fall, and of course there will be a fall in SpO2 also. Now, I think I'm clear. Now, coming to the normal alveolar arterial gradient, there is a formula to calculate this. This is something like H by 4 plus 4 will give a normal alveolar arterial gradient for any patient because it's actually age related. I think the scope of this session is only this much. Patient who is needing oxygen therapy in excess of what we have discussed today might need advanced ventilatory support, which might be a non-invasive ventilation or a full ventilatory support. This will be discussed in the next session. Hello. Hello.
Hello, any doubts on that? Mandali. ഹലോ, എന്തെങ്കിലും ഡൗട്ട്സ് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ മാഡത്തിൻ്റെ അടുത്ത് ചോദിക്കുക. ചോദിക്കുന്നവർ മാത്രം മൈക്ക് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുക ദയവായി.
എക്സ്ക്യൂസ് മീ മാം, ഒരു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ചോദിച്ചോട്ടെ? മാഡം, മോസ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് അവർ ഹോസ്പിറ്റൽസ് മൈറ്റ് നോട്ട് ബി ഹാവിംഗ് എ സെൻട്രൽ ഓക്സിജൻ സപ്ലൈ. വി മൈറ്റ് ഹാവ് ടു യൂസ് ദ വെന്റിലേറ്റർ, മേ ബി വിത്ത് ദ വൺ വിത്ത് ദ കംപ്രസർ ആസ് വെൽ ആസ് വിതൗട്ട് ദ കംപ്രസർ. വി മൈറ്റ് ഹാവ് ടു യൂസ് വിത്ത് ബിഗ് സിലിണ്ടർ, ജംബോ സിലിണ്ടർ. സൊ കെൻ യു ത്രോ സം ലൈറ്റ് ഓൺ വാട്ട് വിൽ ബി ദ സിനാരിയോ? മേ ബി ഹൗ ലോങ് വിൽ ദ സിലിണ്ടർ ലാസ്റ്റ്? Or what are other things which we should be keeping in mind while using the ventilators with the big cylinders?
Madam, question kya tha irno?
ഡൗട്ട്സ് ഉള്ളവർ ചോദിക്കാം, ബാക്കിയുള്ളവർ മൈക്ക് ഒന്ന് മ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുക
ദയവായി.
മാഡം ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ കേട്ടില്ലായിരുന്നു തോന്നുന്നു.
ഹരിശങ്കർ ആ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഒന്നുകൂടെ ചോദിക്കൂ.
മാഡം ഒരു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ചോദിച്ചോട്ടെ. മാഡം
ചോദിച്ചു, ഹരിശങ്കർ ചോദിക്കുന്നുണ്ട്.
രണ്ട് ദിവസത്തേക്ക് കഴിച്ചപ്പോൾ കഴിഞ്ഞ് കൂടുതൽ കുറവെങ്ങനെയാണെന്ന് നോക്കാം. വെയിറ്റ് കഴിച്ചിട്ട് ആഹാരത്തിന് ശേഷം കഴിക്കുമ്പോൾ അതിനോടൊപ്പം ന്യൂട്രോളും രാവിലെയും വൈകിട്ടും ബി കോംപ്ലക്സും.
ഹലോ
ഹരിശങ്കർ, ആ ചോദ്യം ഒന്നുകൂടെ ചോദിക്കും. മാഡം കേട്ടില്ല.
മാഡം, മോസ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് അവർ ഹോസ്പിറ്റൽ മൈറ്റ് നോട്ട് ബി ഹാവിംഗ് എ സെൻട്രൽ ഓക്സിജൻ സപ്ലൈ. വി മൈറ്റ് ഹാവ് ടു യൂസ് ദ വെന്റിലേറ്റേഴ്സ് maybe with the compressor or without the compressor. We might have to use it with a big jumbo cylinder. Yeah. So can you throw some light on how long will the ventilator, that means the gas supply, last? Maybe how frequently we will have to change the cylinders?
The other thing, particularly speaking, long back only I have used with use these cylinders with those compressors. Currently I am not working with those ones with central supply, but ideally this oxygen will be used for the compressors as well. So I think should have a close watch on the pressure gauge.
Those who want to ask question, please raise your hand. Otherwise, everybody will be muted. Everybody is default muted. But they, if you want to ask something, please raise your hand. വേറെ എന്തെങ്കിലും സംശയമുണ്ടോ? രജു, ഡോക്ടർ രജു, എന്തെങ്കിലും സജഷൻസ് പറയാനുണ്ടോ?
ഇല്ല, ഒന്നുമില്ല, ഒന്നുമില്ല, പ്രത്യേകിച്ചില്ല.
ഹലോ ഡോക്ടർ.
ഹലോ
ഷീന, ചോദിച്ചോളൂ.
ഹലോ, കേക്കുന്നില്ലല്ലോ.
മാഡം പോയി.
ഒരു പ്രാക്ടിക്കൽ ടിപ്പ് കൂടെ പറയാനുള്ളത് ഈ സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സിന്റെ കാര്യം ചോദിച്ചത് കൊണ്ട്
ഹലോ
ഒരു പ്രാക്ടിക്കൽ ടിപ്പ് കൂടെ പറയാനുള്ളത് സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സിന്റെ കാര്യം പറഞ്ഞതുകൊണ്ട് നമ്മൾ ട്രാൻസ്ഫർ ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ ഈ ടൈപ്പ് സിലിണ്ടറോ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഏത് ടൈപ്പ് സിലിണ്ടർ ആണെങ്കിലും അതിന്റെ മാക്സിമം വോളിയം എത്രയാണെന്നുള്ളത് മനസ്സിലിരിക്കണം. ഒരു 1900 PSI ഒരു ഈ ടൈപ്പ് സിലിണ്ടറിലുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ഒരു കാൽക്കുലേഷൻ മനസ്സിലുണ്ടാകണം 660 liters ആണ് ഫുൾ സിലിണ്ടറിലുള്ളത്. പക്ഷേ ഒരു ഫ്രീ സ്റ്റാൻഡിങ് സിലിണ്ടർ ഫുള്ളായിട്ടുള്ള ഫ്രീ സ്റ്റാൻഡിങ് സിലിണ്ടറിലും കുറച്ച് ലീക്കൊക്കെ വരാം. അപ്പൊ എല്ലാ സമയത്തും നമ്മളത് യൂസ് ചെയ്യുന്ന ഫ്രഷ് ആയിട്ട് ട്രാൻസ്പോർട്ടിന് എടുക്കുമ്പോൾ സിലിണ്ടർ ഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്യുന്ന സമയത്ത് പ്രഷർ ഗേജിൽ ഒരു കണ്ണ് വേണം, എത്ര ആണ് അവിടെ കാണിക്കുന്ന പ്രഷർ. അപ്പൊ അതനുസരിച്ചാണ് നമ്മൾ മനസ്സിൽ ചിന്തിക്കേണ്ടത് ഇത്രയും വോളിയം ഇസ് ലെഫ്റ്റ് ഫോർ ദ ട്രാൻസ്ഫർ. അപ്പൊ ഞാൻ മുമ്പേ പറഞ്ഞ കൺവേർഷൻ ഫാക്ടർ മനസ്സിൽ ഓർമ്മയില്ലെങ്കിലും എ ഫുൾ സിലിണ്ടർ വിത്ത് 2000 PSI വിൽ ക്യാരി 660 liters ഓഫ് ഓക്സിജൻ. അത് 1000 PSI ആണെങ്കിൽ ഡെഫിനറ്റ്ലി ഓക്സിജൻ കണ്ടന്റ് വിൽ ബി ലെസ് ദാൻ ഹാഫ്, 330 liters താഴെ ആയിരിക്കും. അപ്പൊ നമ്മള് കൺവേർഷൻ ഫാക്ടർ ഒന്നും ഓർമ്മയില്ലെങ്കിൽ റഫ് ആയിട്ട് റൂൾ ഓഫ് തംബ് ആയിട്ട് ഇത് ഓർത്താല് ഈ 330 liters പോകുന്ന ഒരാള് 10 liters ആണ് നമ്മൾ ഫ്ലോ റേറ്റ് സെറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് വിടുന്നതെങ്കിൽ ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ലാസ്റ്റ് ഓൺലി ഫോർ 30 minutes അപ്രോക്സിമേറ്റ്ലി. ഇതൊരു ചെറിയ ട്രാൻസ്ഫറിന് പോലും മതിയാവില്ല. അപ്പം എന്ത് ടൈപ്പ് ഓഫ് ട്രാൻസ്ഫർ, ഇൻഹൗസ് അല്ല ഇൻ ഹോസ്പിറ്റൽ ട്രാൻസ്ഫർ ഫോർ എ സി ടി സ്കാൻ, ഒരു MRI ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള ഒരു ട്രാൻസ്ഫറിനാണെങ്കിൽ പോലും വി ഹാവ് ടു മേക്ക് ഷുവർ ഈ ഒരു സമയത്തിനകത്ത് ട്രാൻസ്ഫർ നടക്കുന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ മാത്രമേ ആ സിലിണ്ടർ കൊണ്ട് പോകാവൂ, ഓർ എൽസ് അഡീഷണൽ സിലിണ്ടർ ഷുഡ് ബി അറേഞ്ച്ഡ്. അപ്പം ഒരു ലോങ് ആംബുലൻസ് വഴി ട്രാൻസ്ഫർ ആണ്, ആംബുലൻസിൽ വലിയ സിലിണ്ടേഴ്സ് ഒക്കെ ഉണ്ടാവും, എങ്കിലും നമ്മൾ ട്രാൻസ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്യുമ്പം അതിനകത്തെയും ഓക്സിജൻ്റെ അളവൊന്ന് ശ്രദ്ധിച്ചിരിക്കണം, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഹാഫ് വേ ഓക്സിജൻ തീർന്നു എന്നുള്ള പ്രശ്നങ്ങളൊക്കെ വരാം. ഹലോ,
ഡോക്ടർ ലീബ ചോദിച്ചോളൂ, ലീബ ചോദിക്കൂ. Thank you, Renju madam, for the very informative talk.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity also. Thank you for patient listening.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.